But that's what's in store. Now, what I wanted to do to save time, because I have so much to cover here, instead of reading the text, I'm just going to put the text on the screen. Normally, I like to put it up, read it, and then I comment on it. I'm just going to put the text on the screen, hopefully keep the right text up there, the text that I'm commenting on. I think that'll save me a few minutes. And if I'm unable to finish, I just really can't gauge it. If I'm unable to finish the notes, I've now put up all the notes for the entire Roman series at theoutlet.us. You can go up there and see what I'm unable to finish. If I finish early, I finish early. I don't know, but we're gonna go at it. Okay, so in the closing of the letter begins in Romans chapter 15, verse 14, and goes through the end of chapter 16. And in Romans 14, chapter 15, verses 14 to 21, this begins the letter closing, and Paul speaks of his ministry and his travel plans, and he says in verses 14 through 16, he assures the Christians in Rome, whom he's never visited, remember. So he's writing these things that he's written to them. He's never visited Rome. But he assures those Christians there that he didn't intend by his letter to call into question their spiritual maturity. Rather, he says he wrote as he did because God has made him a minister of Christ to the Gentiles. God has made him a minister of Christ to the Gentiles. He serves the gospel, he says, as a metaphorical priest whose role is to present the Gentiles to God as an acceptable offering, meaning as people who've been sanctified by the Holy Spirit. So he says, I've been given this ministry. I wrote to you as I did, not to call into question your spiritual maturity, but because I have been given a ministry by God, I function in a metaphorical way as a priest, and my job is to present the Gentiles as an offering to God, sanctified by the Holy Spirit. This is my ministry. That is why I write to you. You are within the orbit of my ministry. And he says in verse 17 that because he's been called by God in this way, that's what the therefore is at the beginning, because he's been called by God in this way, that he can legitimately boast in Christ about that ministry. It's not boasting about his own achievements. Paul's not doing that, but it's a boasting in what Christ has accomplished through him. And that's the way we need to see everything that we do, is that it is God working through us, working to use us, transforming us. Any good that we do is to his praise and to his glory. He says in verses 18 and the first part of 19 that the success of his ministry, it's due to divine enablement. Christ is the active worker. Paul is simply the instrument. Okay, the success that he has, whatever it is due to divine enablement. It is Christ working through him. See, Gentiles, he says, they were brought to obedience by both word and deed, which includes miracles. It includes the signs and wonders, and all of which was accomplished through the power of the Holy Spirit. So Paul is Christ's instrument as the Spirit of God works through him. And in Paul's case, it's working not only in the person he is, what he's doing, what he's saying, how he's living, but it's also working in the miracles that he performed. And so he says that this glory is Christ. Now the result of this divinely driven ministry, the result of it was that from Jerusalem to Illyricum, which is a coastal province northwest of Macedonia. You can see it if I can find this little laser. You see it circled up there. So here's Paul's travels, but he says all the way from Jerusalem to Illyricum. Walking, by the way. You see, Paul says all the way there that he'd planted strategic churches in those regions. That's what he means. As Knox puts it, he says the message had been proclaimed widely enough, and the church had been planted firmly enough to assure that the name of Christ would soon be heard throughout its borders. So that's what Paul means when he says, I've completed it. He was satisfied that he had done enough and had planted strategic churches enough that the word of Christ was planted there and was going to spread out and fill that territory. So that was his first order of business, and Paul saying that he had completed that. And then he explains in verse 20 that the manner in which this was done was by striving eagerly to preach the gospel where there was no worship of Christ at all. That's how he achieved this planting of churches from Jerusalem all the way to Illyricum. It was done by striving eagerly to preach the gospel where Christ wasn't worshipped at all. In other words, Paul saw his particular mission. He saw that mission as planting strategic churches in virgin gospel territory. That's how Paul saw his role. He would go out to where Christ wasn't worshipped at all. He would plant churches there, establish the churches, and then the word would radiate out from those churches. And that's how he conceived his ministry. Now, of course, fulfilling this pioneer church planting ministry, Paul often engaged in other ministry activities, and he worked with churches that he did not plant, of course, like Antioch. All right, so I mean, but his main strategy, how he saw his role, was doing that. And in verse 20-21, Paul cites Isaiah chapter 52, the second part of verse 15, for the point that his church planting ministry among the Gentiles is fulfilling the Old Testament predictions about Gentiles coming to see and coming to understand the message of the servant of the Lord. So Paul cites Isaiah that is what is occurring in his ministry, is that the Gentiles are coming to see and understand. All right, in chapter 15, verse 22 to 29, Paul speaks of his plans to visit Rome, and he explains in verses 22 to 24 that the demands of this ministry that he's just been talking about, and planting churches all the way from Jerusalem to Illyricum, that the demands of that ministry had often prevented him from coming to Rome. It's not like he was unaware, or he didn't want to, but Paul's been busy. I mean, he's been busy. You look at this guy's life. And so he says that often prevented him from coming to Rome, but having planted churches in those regions sufficient enough that he can say that he thought he was completed the job that he was doing, that having done that, now he hopes to visit Rome on his way to planting the church in Spain. So you just see Paul, I think I've done this. I've completed that. I'm satisfied with the churches that I've established there, that the word is going to spread out and fill those regions. Now I'm going to Spain. But I'm on my way to Spain, I'm coming to you. So Paul tells him about that, and he says in verses 25 to 27 that first, though, he's going to Jerusalem. He's going to Jerusalem to deliver the collection taken from the Gentile mission churches. He's going to take this collection and he's going to deliver it in Jerusalem for the poor saints there. Now you remember that collection is an important part of what Paul has been doing. He planted these churches, then he went and he solicited contributions from people, from the brothers and sisters in these Gentile mission churches. Now, those Gentiles, they weren't legally obligated to send that money. You know, it wasn't like the Jews with the temple tax, but they were indebted to the Jewish Christians as the people through whom they received the blessings of Christ. You see, they understood that and they recognized that. So it wasn't a legal obligation, but they realized that they were debtors to the Jewish Christians because it was through Jews that they had received the blessings of Christ. The salvation of Gentiles, all non-Jews, it comes only by way of the Jewish Messiah. You see, only by way of the Jewish Messiah and the fulfillment of God's promises that he made to Israel. That's why I think it's important to see the church is Jewish at its root. You see, we are the fulfillment of the promises that God made to Israel. He fulfills them to faithful Israel, and then we get grafted in. We then join in, and that's our history. That's our background. And so this is this idea, see, it is a recognition that they are indebted to the Jewish Christians. They are indebted to the Jewish people because of that. Then he says in verses 28 and 29, he says that after delivering the collection and having sealed this fruit to them, which is an interesting phrase, he plans to head to Spain by way of Rome. Now, sealing, the act of sealing, it's often an official affirmation of authenticity. You see, a seal could function that way as this official affirmation of authenticity. So I think what Paul means when he's talking about sealing the collection to them, this collection that he's done, is referring to his vouching for its contents, both in terms of the amount and the purpose. So what I think Paul is saying, after I seal this fruit to them, after I bring them this collection, and I say to them, here is the collection from the Gentiles, this is all of it, and they are giving it to you for the poor among you. You see, so I think in that way, see, he's authenticated it, said all there is to say about it, and then he has delivered it. And with that mission accomplished, Paul knows that his visit to Rome will then be with the full blessings of Christ, in the sense that he knows then that he will not have gone to Rome prematurely. You see, he knows then, when I do that and I finish that task, I then know, because this is obviously on Paul's heart, he's been working at this a good long time. So when he brings that to them and seals it to them, he then knows that he will go to Rome with the blessings of Christ, that he will not have, you know, been pushed to go before he finished what he was convinced God wanted him to do with regard to that collection. Because he's collected it from the Gentiles, he's taken it to them, and then he's sealed it to them, vouched for it, done all he can with it. Then he says he will come with the full blessings of Christ. Now, we don't know if Paul ever made it to Spain. The New Testament gives no indication of Paul having gone to Spain, and there's evidence in the pastoral epistles, certainly later, that Paul is back east of Rome. Okay, so we don't know if he ever made it there, but part of 1 Clement, which is a non-canonical letter, it's written around AD 95, from Clement of Rome to the Christians in Corinth, it can be interpreted as suggesting that Paul did reach Spain. So it's just not clear. We don't know. Did he ever make it to Spain or not? Okay, but Paul, his intent, he wants to go to Spain, and he's going to, he wants to visit Rome on the way. 15:30-33, Paul says in verse 30 to 31, he urges the Christians in Rome to struggle with him in prayers on his behalf, that he might be rescued from the unbelievers in Judea. And I just like this. You know, you and I ask people to pray for us. Well, we're in good company. You see, the apostle's asking people to struggle with him in prayer that he might be rescued from the unbelievers in Judea. And I just like that, because we need one. You say, why does Paul need that? He can pray. He's an apostle. He's tuned in, because there's something about us praying. And so he wasn't afraid or ashamed. He said, you join me in struggling in prayer. So he's not, you know, not a now I lay me down to sleep deal. He's talking about, I want you to petition. I remember I had this, some of you may know Bill Flatt, and he was a professor at Harding Graduate School. Now they call it the Harding School of Theology. But I remember talking about when his wife had breast cancer, and he'd ask people to pray about it. And he'd hear some people pray and this kind of thing. He said, man, he said, I wanted them to beg. You see, that's what he wanted. He wanted people to just beseech God for his wife. And so they're doing fine, by the way. The Lord said, yes, I will. But that's what Paul says here. He urges them to join him in prayers on his behalf. And as we know, in fact, from Acts chapter 21, verses 27 to 36, the Romans took Paul in custody to keep the Jews from killing him. You see, so he says, pray that I'll be rescued. And they're ready to kill him. And here comes Rome and says, no, I think we're gonna take this guy and protect him. And so Paul was, in fact, protected from that. And Paul also wants them to pray that the collection will be accepted by the church in Jerusalem. This collection and its reception by the Jewish Christians, it wasn't only benevolence. It was benevolence. It was intended for the poor saints there, but it wasn't only benevolence. It had huge theological overtones. That's why Paul is so interested in this. This has huge theological overtones. The contribution, it showed the Gentiles' appreciation of Jewish primacy in the gospel. It showed that it was through the Jews that the Messiah came, through the lineage of Abraham, God's promises. He has been faithful to Israel, and it is through the Jew that the Messiah has come, and we are beneficiaries of God's promise to the Jew. And so it was a recognition among these Gentile mission churches of the Jews' primacy in the gospel, and the acceptance of it by the Jewish Christians and those churches. It showed their acceptance of the Gentile churches as one community of faith. Now you could imagine, can't you, your experience of churches that these Paul goes and collects from among all these Gentiles, and Gentiles who sacrificed. You see, I mean, who really sacrificed for this contribution, who begged for the right to be part of the contribution. You know, it wasn't like, hey, we got to go pull teeth and browbeat people to do this. They were saying, let us in on giving sacrificially for this work. And so you could see, though, people come and say, no, we're not going to accept that because we don't like these people, because we have some kind of theological beef with them. And so Paul was concerned about that. He was concerned that, but if they receive it, then it is a powerful signal of the oneness of the community of faith, Jew, Gentile, slave, free, doesn't matter. All one in Jesus Christ. So this had major theological overtones, and that's why Paul's urging them to pray about that. You see, there were conservative Jewish Christian groups that continued to be hostile toward Paul. They continued to be hostile, and Paul's, you know, seeing that, oh, maybe they will prevail and they will persuade people not to accept this gift and only accept it if you can bind the Mosaic law on these Gentiles. You see, so Paul's saying, well, that would then sin. Can you imagine if that had happened? What the history of the church would have been? You see how it would have been, the effect it would have had? I don't know how God would have worked that out, but it would have had ramifications for sure. And so Paul's praying about it. He says that if this happens, you see, if this collection is received by the Jewish Christians, then he might come to them in joy if it's God's will that he come. And see, he always recognizes that. And whether you say that or not, you and I have to live our lives in that recognition. That you and I, tomorrow's not in your hands. I mean, that's just the fact. You don't know what's going to happen. You and I have plans about things we're going to do, but we understand that we live under God, and there may be things that he has in mind. And so anyway, Paul, you see that, not just when he says it expressly, you see that in his life here, but he says that if that happens, if they will receive that, then he might come to them in joy, if it's God's will that he do so, and then in verse, and he'll be refreshed by them. And then in verse 33, it expresses Paul's desire for God's blessing on their community, where he says, may the God of peace be with you all. You see, Paul's just heart, he wants God to bless them. Then we get into 16, and 1 and 2, we have this commendation of the sister Phoebe. Now, Paul commends to the Roman Christians this sister in Christ named Phoebe, and she may well have been the person that carried Paul's letter to the Romans. She might have been the one he gave the letter to and said, here, you deliver this letter to them. She's described as a diakonos of the church in Sincre, which has fueled debate about whether the early church had women deacons. You see, she's described as diakonos. Well, did the early church have women deacons in the sense of servants who were formally appointed to a church office? So this is one of the texts that comes up in that discussion. Well, the word, of course, diakonos, it just means servant. Okay, it means servant, and it's used in that general sense many times in the New Testament. Okay, so you have to look beyond the word itself to determine whether Paul is using it simply as a description of a servant or as a title of an office holder. You have to look, because the word can be either. It can be the office holder of a deacon, or it can simply be a servant. Now, historically, apart from an equally ambiguous reference in Pliny's letter to the Emperor Trajan around AD 110. You remember, he was the Roman official who writes back to the emperor. Now, he's writing in Latin, but we have the same kind of ambiguity in his reference. Does it mean servant generally, or does it refer to an office? So apart from that equally ambiguous reference, there's no mention of female deacons until the 3rd century. And there's a lot of stuff written about churches outside the Bible, early church writings. And there's no mention of female deacons until the 3rd century. And that, see, coupled with the emphasis that you see on male leadership in the church, and coupled with what I consider to be the most likely interpretation of 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 11, I take that as wives of deacons, and I don't want to go and explore that. But those things lead me to think in favor of the general term servant. So I think he's simply referring to Phoebe, not as an office holder of deacon, but Phoebe as a servant of the church. Now, granting, if I'm right about that, granting that she's not a formal deacon, as in the sense of an office holder, granting that, she obviously was an important member, right? I mean, she's obviously an important member of the church in Synchre, and Paul thinks the world of her. And you're going to see this over and over. And sometimes we think just because women can't do all that men do in the church, that somehow they're just a silent partner that sits there and just amens us. Now, these are vibrant, loving, sacrificial servants and ministers for Christ. They just do it in their realm and in their capacity. But it's not like there's, it's all men doing the serving and ministering and all that, and the women just sit over here quiet, you see. No, they're active, you see. They're active, and I think that's important to see. Paul describes her as a benefactor or a patron of many. Douglas Moo says in his commentary, a patron was one who came to the aid of others, especially foreigners, by providing housing and financial aid, and by representing their interests before local authorities. Synchre's status as a busy seaport would make it imperative that a Christian in its church take up this ministry on behalf of visiting Christians. That's pretty important ministry, isn't it? Perfectly fine. Serving Christ, serving the church, doing it this way. Okay, it says, Phoebe then was probably a woman of high social standing and some wealth who put her status, resources, and time at the services of traveling Christians like Paul, who needed help and support. Paul now urges the Romans to reciprocate. Paul says, I owe this sister. This sister has blessed me and served me. And not only has she served me, she served many people. She loves the Lord and is just a dynamite worker for the Lord. Now, you treat her that way. That's what he's saying to them. You make sure that you treat her that way. Now, Paul then in 16, 3 through 16, we have these greetings of the Roman Christians. We have this long since these greetings here. Now, there was a tendency in the ancient world to give certain names to certain kinds of people. I don't know if we still do that. But there was a tendency to give certain names to certain kinds of people. And people, as you can imagine, is true of every aspect of the Bible, people have studied that. People have studied, well, what kinds of names are these and what can we find out about the names? And the studies show that a majority of the names are Gentile, which is partly why you see it's a predominantly Gentile church. Why I went through in the introduction, how did that happen, having started out probably with Jewish Christians going to the synagogue, and we've talked about that. But you can see it's predominantly Gentile, and I think that's why Paul sees it as within his orbit. You see, it's a predominantly Gentile church, and the majority of the names are those of slaves and freedmen, former slaves who'd been freed, or the descendants of slaves and freedmen. So that's an interesting insight into the makeup of the church that you have there. And Paul, in this listing, he refers to at least 3 house churches. You see that in verse 5, verse 14, and verse 15. And as Moose says in his commentary, he says, early Christians did not have large public facilities for meeting. You know, there were some places where they could go. In Jerusalem, you could gather in different places. But he says they didn't have large public facilities for meeting, so they used their own houses. And since even the largest house of the wealthiest Christian would hold no more than 70 or 80 for worship, growth beyond that point required that the Christians split up into house churches. So what you have here are meetings of house churches as the church grew beyond that. And you see, like I say, you see here at least three are referred to in Paul's greetings there. Now in verse 16:7, where he says here, greet Andronicus and Junica, that's received much attention. This verse has received much attention in the discussion about women's role in the church. Phoebe is one that gets attention. This verse is another that gets attention, with some saying, look, it shows that there were women apostles. Okay, I don't think it shows that. There are a couple of issues. There's actually three things that are tied to this before one can make that claim, and you can drop out in any one of those three places, so I think it's very tenuous to argue that. The first is it's not clear in 16:7 whether the second name is a man or a woman. Okay, it's just not certain. It's probably a feminine name. Okay, it's probably a feminine name, Junia. And it's hard to tell because it's in an accusative, so you can't really just look at it and say. You got to figure out and say, okay, what are the possibilities that would wind up with this form of the word? Well, it could be an abbreviated form of a masculine name that could give you that, or it could be the feminine name that could give you that. Now, it's probably the feminine name. This has been hashed out, discussed in many places, and if that's correct, then Andronicus and Junia are probably husband and wife. But as they say, it's possible that it's a masculine name rather than a feminine name. And in fact, you see the masculine name reflected in the American Standard, Revised Standard, NAS, NIV 84. They changed, though. The TNIV and the NIV 2011 went to the feminine name. But it just shows you there's some issue about that. Okay, some lack of certainty about that. If it's two men, then it's just two Jewish brothers in Christ that Paul is saying, you know, say hey to these guys, you know, they're really something to me. So that's the first thing is you can't be certain. Is it Junia or is it Junius? And secondly, it's also unclear whether Paul is saying that Andronicus and Junia, let's take the feminine form, that Andronicus and Junia are themselves apostles who are noteworthy, or whether they are noteworthy to the apostles. Are they of note among the apostles in that they are noteworthy apostles? Or are they of note among the apostles in that they are well known to the apostles? Okay, either one of those. And in fact, a number of recent translations reflect the latter, like the New English Translation, the English Standard Version, the Christian Standard Bible. All three of those reflect the latter, saying well known to the apostles. So first, it's not clear if it's a man or a woman. Okay, probably a woman. Second, it's not certain whether he's saying that they are apostles or simply well known to the apostles. So that's another issue that you have here. And finally, even if you say, okay, look, Andronicus and Junia, it's a husband and wife team, and in fact they are apostles, well, then even in that case, it's probable that the term apostle is used in a non-technical sense, meaning they were traveling missionaries. You see, and you see apostle is used non-technically at times in the New Testament, for example, in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 23. You see it in Philippians chapter 2, verse 25. You can see apostle being used non-technically there. And apostle is used specifically for traveling missionaries in the apostolic fathers, Christians who wrote after the New Testament era. Okay, so you have this idea of then they're traveling missionaries. And in any event, Thomas Schreiner in his commentary says, and this is a comment I agree with, he says, one should scarcely conclude from the reference to Junia and the other women co-workers' names here that women exercised authority over men contrary to the Pauline admonitions in 1 Timothy 2:12. So I think you have to deal with that, recognize that. So I think, you know, I have many things to say about women's role in this kind of thing, but this isn't the time for me to launch into that. Okay? I just think that it is not the same as men's role, but it is powerful and it is, you know, the fact that Paul is saying what he's saying here, and by the way, the difference in roles is not because women are less moral, less intelligent, or any of that. It is because God has chosen to put certain responsibility on certain people. Just like when he says to Levites, you're going to carry the tabernacle, and you got some other tribe saying, I got muscles, I can carry the tabernacle. Well, why did God do that? Well, it's his choice. So he didn't say, I'm not saying that the Levites, that you're too weak to carry it. I'm saying, I'm doing something and you leave that to me and I'm putting this responsibility on men. Not because you're stupid, not because you're immoral, any of that. It is because my sovereign choice, I put this responsibility on men. Okay, that's how I look at it. And you see, and so Paul, you see here, look, it's noteworthy. Paul mentions 9 women in this list. And 5 of them he commends for their labor in the Lord. 5 of the women, he says here, look, these women are knocking it, you know, they're just knocking it out of the park. They're in love with Christ, they're serving and they're doing all of this. They're not a second-class Christian because they're a woman. That's not it. They have a different role, they have a different function. I've given the leadership responsibility to men. Now, women sometimes say, why did he do that? Okay, I get it. But he did it. You see, he did it. And so you have this thing here, but Paul is saying, you have women, as I say, the fact they can't assume all the roles that men do in the church, they were active and important members in the community of faith, and I want sisters to see that. You know, to see, no, I'm serving Christ. Here they are, the traveling missionaries, if it's a reference to them as apostles. Okay, and of course you got Priscilla and Aquila and all that. You know, you go out and the mission teams that we send out, what do they do? What do you think the wife is doing there? You think she's not part of that work? She's an integral part of the work. She's just, there are certain things that she's not doing, but she is serving the Lord Jesus in a way that is commendable. And Paul, you see that there. Now in verse 16, let me just say a note here. Let me go. Verse 16, I always like to touch on this. He says, greet one another with a holy kiss. I don't understand that as a command to kiss. Okay, some people go, well, you don't believe the Bible. You don't believe the Bible. You don't greet one another with a holy kiss. If I thought Paul was saying, I'm commanding you to kiss, I'd be kissing. And as I've said, aren't you glad I don't think that? But I don't think that's what Paul is saying. You see, as Moo says, the kiss was a common form of greeting in the ancient world generally, and in Judaism especially. Paul, in my view, he assumes they'll greet one another by kissing, but his command is that they greet with a holy kiss. You see, he assumes that's how they're greeting. His command relates to the holiness of the greeting that they give one another. He's saying the kiss with which you greet one another is to be holy, meaning it is not to be duplicitous. It is to be a genuine expression of Christian love. You're not to come up here and say, oh, hey, how you doing? This guy over here is just a complete stiff. You see, that's duplicitous. That's the kind of kiss that betrayed our Lord. You see, it's not to be that. It is to be a holy kiss, a kiss that is genuine, a kiss that reflects true Christian love, so that when you come and hug somebody or greet them, that you're not being a phony. You see, you're not scheming against them, and this is just some kind of flattery to put them off guard so I can gut them. No, that's not how it's to be. And I think that's where the focus of it is here, see? It's a, you know, I look at it this way. If a commander wrote to his troops and he said, greet President Obama with a respectful salute, his point wouldn't be that they're to salute. That's a given. You see, in the military context, that would be a given. What he would be saying is, look, when you salute, as you will do in military culture, When you do that, do so with the respect that is due the office of president. You see, so that's where I think the focus is. And I think that we can greet in other ways as culture moves, but however we greet, we obey the command when we do it without duplicity. We do it in a holy way. We do it with genuineness so that there is consistency between our affection and our greeting. That's what I think Paul's saying. Okay, that's kind of a footnote because that's just one little line there, but that comes up with people. Okay, I got to talk here. I don't know if I'm going to get it, but if I don't, then you can go on the website and read it. All right, if you care. It's theoutlet.us. Okay. In 16, 17 to 20, there's a warning and a prayer. In verses 17 and 18, he warns them, Paul warns them to watch out for those who create division in the church and threaten the spiritual lives of the members by teaching what is contrary to what they'd been taught. That's what Paul is worried about. You see, that somebody's going to come in here and they're going to create division, they're going to create dissension in the church, and they're going to threaten the spiritual lives of members. That's when he says, those who create dissensions and causes for offense, causes for stumbling. You see, he's worried about that look, that somebody, you need to watch out for those. Watch out for these guys who come in and threaten the spiritual lives of the members, who threaten their spiritual lives by teaching what is contrary to the teaching which you learned. So what is Paul talking about here, you see? He's talking about, he seems to have a certain group in mind. He seems to be thinking about a certain group. Perhaps he's thinking about the Judaizers who plagued his ministry. Right? Paul would go in and he would build a church and plant a church. And what are these guys? Like vultures. They're hanging out waiting. Let's go over here. Let's go to the churches in Galatia. Let's go tell them that they must submit to all the Mosaic law or they can't be saved. And see, they follow and they would go and they cause trouble in different places. So maybe Paul is thinking about those guys who plagued his ministry. And Paul tells these Christians in Rome that they are to avoid or turn away from these false teachers because those teachers are not serving the Lord and because they're able to deceive the unsuspecting with smooth talk. As I've said many times, heretics never come and say, I'm a heretic. Hear me now. They never do that. They always come and say, I have greater insight. I have greater insight. You see, and Paul is warning them. He says, you watch out for these people who are going to come in and be selling stuff that's contrary to the gospel that was preached to you that you know. And you're going to come in, they're going to come in and start, they're going to alter it. They're going to tell you something different. And they're going to say it's deep and rich, and they've got better insight. And Paul says, you watch out for them. That's why elders, you see, are charged. You shepherd the flock and you watch this false teaching. You can't have it invade the sheep because it is deadly. And so Paul winds up and he tells them that. And he notes in verse 19 that the existence of the church in Rome was well known. And see, with that kind of a profile, it's only a matter of time before the wolves arrive. See, that's why he has four at the beginning of 18. He says, you watch out for these guys who come in and create dissensions and causes for offense contrary to teaching. For such people don't serve our Lord Christ but our own belly. Sorry, 4 and 19. He says, through smooth speech, well-chosen words, they deceive the hearts of the unsuspecting. 4, you watch out for those guys coming. Why? Because your existence is known far and wide. Well, what does that mean? That'll draw them. Like moths to a flame. When they hear about you, they're going to come here and they're going to sow their dissension. They're going to sow all this kind of stuff and their false teaching. As F.F. Bruce puts it, he says, they should not be so simple-minded as to swallow whatever is offered. You see, Paul sits here, he says, look, he wants them to be innocent in terms of evil, but he wants them to be wise, meaning not naive in terms of false teaching. You know, and that's sometimes it's a balance. Because you always say that we're so afraid of challenging false teaching, that kind of thing, because we don't want to become pharisaical and be hard-hearted and jumping on everybody. So we just say, who cares? But you can't do that because there is heresy. And so Paul is warning them about that, you see. We can't be, as Bruce says, just so simple-minded as to swallow whatever's offered. I think this is the idea behind Jesus saying in Matthew 10:16 about being wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Innocent with regard to evil, but wise not being naive. Not just swallowing whatever somebody says, because there are wolves out there. You see, there are wolves and there are false teachers. And as they practice that discernment that he's urging them to practice when these people show up having heard about the church because they're known far and wide, when they arrive, you practice that discernment. And in doing that, God will give them swift victory over the Satan-inspired heretics who arrive to trouble them. See, he will swiftly deal with them. Exercise this discernment. And then Paul adds a prayer for the grace of the Lord Jesus that it be with him. Okay, 16:21-24. I'm trying. I'm not going to let you leave till I'm finished. So, okay. 21-24. Paul's companions here, you see, this is these guys. Now, they want to say hey to people in Rome. All right, so here are some of Paul's companions. Say, hey, hi from me. You know, isn't that perfectly, just the way you'd want to say, hey, tell them I said hey. All right, so this is what's going on here. And Paul's companions here, they include their greetings for the brothers and sisters. Jason, who's mentioned, is probably the person from Thessalonica who's mentioned in Acts chapter 17, verses 5 to 7 and verse 9. Sosipater's probably the Berean named Sopater in Acts chapter 20, verse 4. Tertius is the secretary who wrote down under Paul's direction. He's the guy who's actually been writing the letter. You know, call it amanuensis. It's a secretary who sits here and takes the letter down. Gaius is probably the same person who's mentioned in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 14. You remember one of the ones Paul baptized? That's probably that Gaius. Erastus is here. He's described as the city's treasurer. And this is probably the same person for whom there's an inscription uncovered in Corinth, referring to Erastus. It's probably the same person. And Quartus, we don't know anything about Quartus. He just refers to him, maybe he tacks it on because everybody else had something to say. He just says, Quartus, the brother. He says, hey to you also. 16:25-27. You see, we're going to make it. Okay, 16:25-27. I'm going to read this one, then I'm going to comment, then you're out. Okay, you've done your duty. All right, 16:25-27. Now to him who is able to establish you in accordance with my gospel, that is, the preaching of Jesus Christ, in accordance with the revelation of the mystery, having been kept silent through times eternal, but now having been displayed, and through the prophetic scriptures, in accordance with the command of the eternal God, having been made known for bringing about the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles to the only wise God through Jesus Christ, to him be glory forever. Amen. So Paul concludes this masterful, this beautiful letter to the Roman Christians. He ends it with this doxology in praise of God, who has, in the gospel of Jesus Christ, has revealed the climax of salvation history. God has been working. He has been working all along, and with his Son, the page has turned, and the kingdom has come. The kingdom has arrived, and you and I live in that, waiting only the consummation of the kingdom that was already inaugurated with Christ's coming. Let me read to you this comment by Thomas Schreiner, and then I'm through. He says, talking about these texts, these verses, he says, Paul prays that God will receive the glory for the gospel that has now been revealed. This gospel was both hidden and prophesied in the Old Testament, but the age of fulfillment has come so that the mystery that was shrouded in the past and prophesied is now publicly declared and being fulfilled. The gospel centers on Jesus the Messiah, for he fulfills the saving promises of the Old Testament, and these promises are being realized in the inclusion of all nations into the people of God. As the Gentiles exercise the obedience that comes from faith, they show that they are the children of Abraham. God's saving plan, which includes Jews and Gentiles, and is effected through Jesus the Messiah, is wisely constructed so that he receives that glory and praise forever. All right, thank you for coming.